Hello, good morning everybody. This is Francesca Riolo from Parma in Italy. First of all, I would like to thank Pablo and the organizers for inviting me to present the project of the food forest, of the Picasso food forest. And I also want to compliment for organizing such an important event because we need to promote more permaculture, urban permaculture, and also try to bring it within the academic environment to get some research involved into it, some formal research. I will give you first a very short introduction about the history of food forests. Then I will get into more details on the project I'm working on. And hopefully I will also leave some space for questions because there are many aspects of this project. And depending on the people present at the conference, one aspect might be more of interest than others. But I will try to give first a wider overview. So, what is food foresting? Man has cultivated according to nature within forest systems beginning thousands of years ago. There are several witnessing aspects in some wild forest that still mark the work of man done to cultivate foods within this system. For example, we have examples in Amazonian forest in Africa. There are some interesting papers published about it. The idea of cultivating like a forest was then adapted to modern times by Robert Hart in UK around the 70s. One of the oldest modern food forests that you can visit that has over 25 years of age already is located in UK Devon and is run by Martin Crawford. And I was pleased and lucky enough to be able to visit it. And I really highly recommend to go there if you want to have an idea of what a mature food forest might look like. And it's really impressive. We also have a very old food forest in Italy. I haven't visited this one yet, but it's of course in my calendar. It's in the Brescia Ara and is run by Onorio Belussi. One of the first time that the food forest design approach and concept was used on public land was in 1997 when the George Washington Carver Edible Park was opened in Asheville in North Carolina in the USA. So this was the first time that food foresting was entering the urban environment and it was made accessible to the citizens of a city. But it was only in after the financial crisis in 2008 that food forest projects started to increase in number within the urban environment, especially in the USA. And now there are over 65 projects registered that include, of course, food production within the urban context. And that are again public. This is an important aspect. Slowly, the urban food forest concept is also gaining attention within the institutional environment. For example, food forests are mentioned in Austin's urban forest plan. Calgary, for example, Calgary City mentioned the creation of food forest or orchards within the urban environment. In the Netherlands, Utrecht is planning the 16-hectare food forest around a new residential project. In Slovenia, cultivating fruit orchard in public spaces within the city was part of their planning, urban planning, that allowed them to win the European Green Capital Award in 2016. And then we have probably everybody knows this example, the Beacon Food Forest in Seattle, that in 2009 gained public funding of $120,000 to get it started. And it's with its 3 hectares, is the biggest food forest, urban food forest in USA. This was another major recognition that urban food forest gained very recently. Let's say they made it to the FAO guidelines on urban and peri-urban forestry, where FAO invites municipality to include food forest and community gardens into urban planning to contribute to food security and to the provision of ecosystem services. They suggest to use public spaces to host forest and food forest and community gardens. And they invite them to eliminate any barriers that could slow down the development of food forests. You really see urban food forestry mentioned within the guidelines, and they also recognize that food forestry, urban food forestry, can help contribute to achieve two of the sustainable development goals of UN, that is zero hunger and sustainable cities and community. So SDGs 2 and 11. But likely you can add additional SDGs because food forestry covers so many social and environmental aspects that the list I think can be longer than this even. So there is a shared definition of urban food forestry, that is the intentional and strategic use of woody perennial food producing species in urban edible landscapes. So this would include not only urban food forests, but also green areas that would include and host fruits and edible plants, as well as street fruit trees. So also less formally designed areas, but they still host edible plants. Urban food forestry requires a number of actors to be successful, institution, active citizens, professional, and academia, where active citizens is really is recognized as an essential part. While of course institutions can provide how to say, the legal framework within which citizens can act, and professionals and academia can bring additional knowledge to the implementation part of this project. Before getting into the Picasso Food Forest project, I here show you a different type of urban food forestry. It's an example we have here in Parma. This is a street where there are present 62 plants of persimmon. Around this street, we organize every year a so-called harvest day, where citizens come in and harvest the fruits from the trees. Actually, this initiative was born because people that lost the attachment to the meaning of these trees in the city were asking the council, the municipality, to cut down all these trees because fruits were making the footpath dirty. So we worked on that, and we managed to convince them that we could actually harvest and enjoy what nature was producing right at our doorsteps, beside all other ecosystem services that the trees were providing us, like clean air, habitat for biodiversity, and also regulation of the temperature in the summer months. Food forestry is gaining also attention within the research in the academia environment. There are already a few papers mentioning and talking about it. For example, Clark and Nicholas in 2013 concluded substantial untapped potential exists for urban food forestry to contribute to urban sustainability via increased food security and landscape multifunctionality. Then we have Poe and MacLean et al. In 2012 that I highlight the socio-cultural value of foraging in urban environments. And last year, the Urban Forestry and Urban Greening Journal launched a call to collect papers and articles about and research about urban food forest, a special issue, to be collecting special issues. And the study and the project I'm going to present was indeed used as a base for an article that is now included in this collection that is titled The Social and Environmental Value of Public Urban Food Forest, the Case Study of the Picasso Food Forest in Parma, Italy. So let's get into the project. As said, we are located in Parma, in the north of Italy, within the Po Valley. As far as climate, is USGS Hardiness Zone 8, where we have hot summers and rainy and wet winters, even if with climate change now things starting to get quite erratic. We start having long drought periods, floods, so it's a bit things are definitely changing. And the area is a L-shaped geometric area of about half an hectare, located within a residential neighborhood. While starting planting, we were also looking at some aspect of the project, such as solar radiation. A solar radiation analysis was run using a geographical information system software, where all the landscape features surrounding the area were put into the map to calculate how many hours of sunshine were available in the area. And it's clear that the area received a considerable amount of sunshine hours during the summer. As you can see, most of the part receives more than 13 or 11 to 16 hours of sun every day. Of course, a little bit less in spring and autumn, but still more than 11 hours per day. And in winter, the northern part is a bit more shaded, but it's important to have more sunshine during the vegetative period than when the plants are resting. So this does not create a big issue on the fruit trees, for example. But as you know, permaculture says that if you have shade, then you just pick the right plants for shade. And this is what we, of course, try to do when we plan what plants to put where. We also run a wind analysis. We did not take any steps towards wind management. We are in an urban environment, so wind doesn't play a major role, but we might still think to work on it because, as you can see, there are some directions on which we have some prevalent wind that it could maybe manage using some wind barrier. So this was the site before we started the planting. This was the site in December 2012. Was a green lawn maintained by the municipality with several cutting every year with removal also of what they're mowing. This probably brought, how to say, was making the soil also poor because everything was always removed. All the organic material. This was the 23rd December 2012. That's when the first planting occurred. This was a group of citizens that decided to, to make a Christmas gift to the neighborhood. And we started with the first planting of the first seven trees. And from there, we never stopped. This was the area after first planting. And this is the area about 2 years ago. So as you can see, he moved from a flat meadow to a much more complex three-dimensional young woodland. This is how it looks like from the inside. I assume you already have an idea about the food forest approach, that is the cultivation according to the model of a young woodland. So a three-dimensional models where you work on several vertical layers of vegetation to boost productivity and biodiversity. You introduce in the space the taller trees that will create the canopy of the woodland, and then you have the lower trees, the shrubs, the herbaceous layers, the layers that covers the ground, and then on top of this you can put a climbing layer. And you also have the underground layers, for example, for roots or bulbs, vegetables. Here you can see already different components we added to the ecosystem. You see several fruit trees. You see some perennial vegetables that contribute to the herbaceous layers, several aromatic herbs, strawberries, and nitrogen fixers. And we'll talk more about this later. And of course, also the animal component that is very important to have a balanced system, pest control, for example. So with this biodiversity, it's possible to attain natural processes that are at the base of the correct and healthy functioning of the ecosystem. We have, of course, CO2 cycle, water cycle, nutrient cycle through a healthy soil, and a food web that allows for pest control. And of course, we have people, another very important part of the system, especially because we are in an urban environment. So we have not only agronomic aspects, but this project has very important also social aspects that I will on which I will give you more details soon. And then you have all the aspects that you attain. You can have social aspects such as people well-being, improved know-how, education, health, community resilience, and then you have aspects, for example, the provision of ecosystem services, ecological processes, the creation of habitat to host biodiversity, the development of soil fertility, food production. Let's now give some more details how we implemented this. As I mentioned, we followed the food forest vertical layers model. We did not do any initial special soil preparation. Nevertheless, we were starting from a very poor soil, where very low in organic matter and full of some debris of the previous construction site. All we did was just digging holes that were about the size of the plant's roots, and we planted the plant. What we really put attention on, and I will say it in the next slide, was mulching. So starting to improve the soil from that on. As far as the location of the plants, we follow the quincunx pattern to optimize space usage. We experimented with different sun exposure. Of course, we were planting the taller plants towards the north side and the lower plants, smaller plants towards the north side. But depending also on the plants, we could not stick to this rule. For example, there were some shrubs that we realized they preferred to have some shade. So we were planting them on the north side of the taller plants. And there was actually, we had some very successful example on how that worked well. We were spacing fruit trees at least 5 meters apart to allow space between tree canopies at maturity. Of course, at the beginning, it's, the area it looks like it's not full enough, and people tend to put plants too close to each other. But you have to try to put some effort to imagine how big the plants will be in maturity, making sure you don't plant them too close, but leave enough space to have sun still able to reach the ground and maturity. The distance between shrubs was instead about 2 meters. Of course, there are exceptions also to this rule, depending on specific cases. We tried to maximize biodiversity and functions. We were not following a really strict rule on a specific plants association, but we really thought that biodiversity is the key, and for several reasons. And we're also looking at functions. So we were introducing plants that could produce food, but also be helpful to the ecosystem, but by providing habitats, for example, to predatory insects, or providing food to birds, or being nitrogen fixers. And I will talk about this soon. And of course, we volunteer plants are welcome in the system because they contribute to biodiversity and also to organic matter production and several other functions, including often being edible and not requiring any maintenance work to get them going. Here we see some examples of these layers mixing. We have smaller trees and older bushion layers around them. On the right side, you see cardoons. This is very successful plants. They produce a lot of organic matter, and we highly suggest, at least in our climate and soil situation, to use them because they are really they don't require any maintenance, and they produce food. They produce food for people and for animals because they also have this important flowering season that provides a lot of food for pollinators. Here are other examples of so-called guilds, that is plants, trees in the middle of several herbaceous plants around them. As I said, we gave particular attention to soil protection. We use wood chips for mulching and leaves during the autumn. We collect, we ask a citizen to bring us leaves that we use for mulching the soil around the plants.
Ми
8 minutes left.
Чуємо
8. Oh wow, there's not gonna be time for questions, aren't there? So we didn't use any type of fertilizing. We instead used nitrogen fixing shrubs and also annual beans. We plant, for example, broad beans around the trees, and we have so the double function of nitrogen provision and food production. We also think that dog urine might play a role as a source of fertilizer because the area is very popular for dog walking. We leave the pest control to the other inhabitants of the system, so birds and pests. We mow walking trails around the area so people can easily access it, but we try to be gentle on all the other vegetation. We just cut down spontaneous plants that might interfere with those that we cultivated, but for the rest, we try to leave them freely growing. We keep records of the biodiversity. We have over 200 plant species, of which 32 through fruit trees, most of them heirloom, and 24 shrubs, 76 edible herbaceous plants, 78 voluntary species recorded so far, 16 species of mushroom. And you can find the full list on our website. We recorded over 200 animal species among all different orders of insects, spiders, 51 birds, besides lizards, slugs, snails, hedgehogs, hares. All this in an urban environment, so it's pretty exceptional. And also let people know what does it mean to have some green space in the city. You can also have nature in the city if you leave some space to it. We have some pictures about the fruit produced in the area. This is a heirloom variety of peach. We paid particular attention also to include heirloom varieties that were particularly resistant to disease. And so the area also works as a genetic bank, so people can come and take what they need to make, for example, grafting for heirloom varieties. These are the shrub layers with a big biodiversity, the herbaceous layer, ground layer. But it's not the only the agronomic side of the project is important. For us, it's very important also the social part of the project. As far as people engagement, it takes place at several levels, in several modalities. First of all, the unique characteristic of this project is that it is an open area. Everybody can access the area and harvest the food produced. This is to try to let the highest number of people getting closer to this concept and to the benefits that are produced by this by this project. We have a group of about 15 activists that runs the project in a continuous manner, and then we have several people left taking part to the various activities. We involve schools, youth groups, other NGOs. Of course, the area is popular for taking kids to explore nature and food production. We organize different type of open door labs for kids and adults. A seed exchange event, social event around food. As I said, we invite schools to make activities. We get also international visitors. These are Erasmus Plus schools from Bulgaria. They came to visit us for in the past 2 years. Youth centers, private companies, they send us volunteers once a year in their volunteer day event, NGO. And one important aspect of the project is to set a case study for other people to get inspired on. And this was probably one of the most successful aspects of our project, because we have people that came to visit us and then they went back home and started their own project. And this for us is a very nice aspect. We organize free courses of plant identification, pruning, composting. Of course, institutional involvement was an aspect of this project. Thanks to this, we managed to get food forest mentioned in the local law. So we set the legal basis for other citizens wishing to develop similar initiative by our collaboration with the local municipality. And food forest now is recognized as one of the ways that citizens can manage public area by making a formal request to the municipality. Main challenges, definitely unprecedented case within the legal framework, 100% volunteer active citizenship base. We did not receive any funding from anybody. It was all self-financed. The open access setup that I mentioned, of course, is brings its own challenges, but nothing too important. We had some problem with people perceiving the area as not tidy enough. So we invested a lot of work in environmental interpretation, explaining why we do not keep just a very short lawn or square shrubs, but we leave a bit more space to nature and its guests, and how useful, why insects are useful and not bad. And then the unusual location. In Parma, there is a strong movement of sort of community garden, but it's the one where you get a private allotment, and these spaces are all allocated to the margin of the cities, while this food forest is really within a residential area. And then all the main achievements probably you know well about, like all the ecosystem services produced by such a ecosystem, learning opportunities, community building, people start to get attached to this place that before was not really used or attended. It became a biodiversity hotspot, clearly a genetic bank for heirloom varieties, an opportunity to talk about the food forest concept. It's very important also the storytelling part that we really put some effort in through publishing things on the web and the Facebook page, and so the news start also to be spread in newspaper, magazine. We had major Italian channels coming featuring the project. And this, of course, is useful to the cause of spreading the message and talking about the food forest concept. Conclusion, we believe that urban food forests represent not just a model to rethink how cities should be designed, but also how us as a species shall provide for our needs to live on this planet, that is, of course, a sustainable, harmonious way. I hope there is some time for some questions. Otherwise, you see here my contact details, and you can, of course, send your questions, and I will be very happy to answer them.
Thank you very much, Francesca. I'm afraid that we are again a little bit tight with the time, so I propose that we would have a time for one or two questions. Is it fine with you?
Yes, fine with me.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Хто має запитання? Будь ласка.
Чи доцільно вирощувати
фрукти? Is it reasonable to plant fruit trees and shrubs close to the roads with the intense movement of vehicle and cars because of pollution? What do you think? Does it affect this street pollution, the quality of food we grow?
Okay, in our case, the street is very small. It's a one-way small street with very low traffic, so it should not be a problem. Also, there is evidence that fruit trees do not absorb typical urban pollution. We made analysis, for example, on the persimmon produced on the other project that I showed you, because that were in a more polluted area, and they showed that fruits were just fine, and probably even better than what you can get in the supermarket, because they did not have any trace of pesticides, for example. So definitely something that you need to keep an eye on, but very often the area will be okay to produce food within the urban environment, because pollution is not absorbed by the fruits. This to give a very short answer. Of course, it's a complex subject. Actually, we have on our top list producing some a synthesis of the evidence on this subject to better investigate all the aspects.
Говорювати і досліджувати. І останнє питання. Хто ще не задавав питання?
Ні, утвердимо.
Добре, давайте.
Чи проводиться якісь заходи стосовно підвищення стійкості до шкідників і антивандальності?
Do you... Do you make any measurements? Regarding the vandalism and what
and
else?
Pest protection.
And pest protections in your urban gardens.
Vandalism, you said?
And pest protection. What do you do to protect your urban gardens against vandalism and pests?
Okay. Against vandalism, we just put patience. We just want to be more, how to say, constant than whoever does some damage. We did not have any major problem. Now and then some plants disappear, but we try not to make a big deal about it and just go on, because the good is being so far much higher than the bad. So it's not really creating a problem, only very minor events. As far as pest control, we don't do anything ourselves. We just maximize biodiversity and let nature taking care of it. So if a plant is attacked by aphids, for example, we just wait long enough and the ladybug will be there. And we had many examples of where these things worked really, really well. So we are really not doing anything, even not organic treatment, for example. These two, of course, also reduce the maintenance to a minimum, because even organic treatments would require some effort. And we are trying to avoid that and really try to make natural cycles work.
Thank you very much, Francesca, for your wonderful presentations.
Okay, thank you very much to you and people for listening. Yeah.